As soon as videotape left the factory, it already started to break down. Information that is on the tapes is slowly dying, and if we don't preserve them, important historical content that's contained on them will be lost forever.
What is MePops?
What is MePops?
What is MePops? MePops stands for Moving Image Preservation of Puget Sound.
What MePops does for the general public of the Pacific Northwest is provide access to digitized content.
Our mission is to raise awareness about the magnetic media crisis, the alarm that the Association of Moving Image Archivists sounded to sort of bring awareness to the urgency of digitizing videotape.
Audiovisual Archive in Australia has put a deadline of 2025 to say, if you don't have your magnetic material digitized by this time, you're screwed. They're figuring out the actual date, and it's right around the corner.
Within 20 to 30 years of the time it's created, it's disintegrating.
The magnetic media crisis is sometimes called a gathering storm because the deterioration of the actual analog videotapes and then the increasing obsolescence and rarity of the players that play them back.
So video is a little bit different from film in that video went through all these different iterations, all these different formats for consumer purposes, for broadcast purposes, whereas film, there were consumer formats, 16mm, 8mm, but the principle of film has stayed pretty consistent. And video requires all these different players.
A lot of the formats that we work with stopped being manufactured years ago. And so we have to make sure that we take good care of them and tune them up, clean them, because a lot of the parts and players are getting harder and harder to come by, and so are the people who actually work on them. They're a dying breed, if you will.
In some cases, people thought they were creating preservation copies by putting film onto videotape. In fact, that was not a great idea. Film is actually quite stable.
The thing about older media types like film and negatives is that they are stable. 30 years from now, you're going to be able to view them.
100-year-old nitrate film, in some cases, is still around and looks gorgeous. Whereas video, for its manufacture, had a completely different purpose. It was more of a kind of democratizing format for shooting.
It was a lot cheaper than film, so not only were professionals using it, but also amateurs and just the average person was able to buy videotape and record.
There was plenty of access. You could watch your VHS tape of a film, but now that VHS tape needs a lot of help. We have to keep up. We can't just sort of settle back and say, okay, we're finished. Despite the fact that we're working with old materials that have their fixed content, the way we view that material, the way we store that material is going to just keep changing and evolving.
A lot of the time, videotape is capturing real people doing real things. That might sound personal and boring, but it really encompasses so much of Seattle and Seattle's history that it's valuable to the general public and great for them to be able to access it. The public is able to see files digitized at MePops on Internet Archive, where we create collections for each group so that they can, based on that institution, go in and view the content on their personal computer.
Take everything a little too far. seeing them, someone else's eyes, seeing them, and I'm seeing through those eyes. I'm frightened, of course. I'm always frightened. That's why I'm here, aren't I? I want to leave, but there's a barrier. I can't move. It's a surface, and it's wet. And there's something on the other side of the surface. Something red.
looking at television this morning, they showing a carnival over in Brazil. I said, shh. They couldn't give me a trip there. You know, this time of year, Mardi Gras, no way in the world. They could be giving me a first class trip, limousine service, everything. No, baby, we wait till after Mardi Gras. Like, my birthday is Saturday, the 16th. You know what I'm saying? Them are 2 days I look for. See, Mardi Gras, it's like Christmas, Easter, everything rolled into one. You know, when most people be celebrating Christmas or Thanksgiving or other holiday, you be saying, look, they don't even have to have them days. All they need is Mardi Gras, you know? Feelings is when you hear a tambourine. See, when my council chief come to my house tomorrow morning and he hit the tambourine, boy, it's like your blood pressure goes up. You know, you go to get nervous, you say, oh man, your house be packed and jammed. You have people sewing that you don't even know, you know. Then when you get it on and you look at it, you know, you don't really get a chance to see yourself until you go in front of a store window, one of these plate glass. Then you see it, and if the sun is right behind you, boy, it looks so beautiful. Wow. And then you say, somebody must have liked me up there in heaven. And then you just hear the tambourine singing, you know. People singing behind you, the Indian songs. But I think what really hyped me up Mardi Gras morning, when I put my suit on and I walk out my door, and I get to the corner. But when I get to the corner, I start saying a prayer, singing Indian is the Indian prayer. You know what I mean? You know what I'm saying? And you be hoping. Like you're responsible, you know, not legally, but in your mind, you know, you're responsible for your neighborhood. You don't want nobody child to get hurt, you know, you don't want nobody to get hurt, you know. So when you're meeting the gang, your spy boy sends a signal back to the back. Now, when he sends that signal, he gonna tell you who it is, you know. If you want to meet him, you meet him. You don't want to meet him, you pass by. See, a long time ago, the upper class people in New Orleans had this idea that everybody masked Indian was like a criminal or somebody had questionable characters, you know. And now it's a business, you know. You go to the jazz fest, you go to the this place, you go to that place, you're signing contracts and dumb stuff, you know? And a lot of time you used to say, if the wrong person get a hold of your suit, they're gonna copy it. You can't copy a suit. Because, you know, when you see Charles' suit gonna be entirely different from mine, you know? Your heart and soul, like, you know, you hear people used to say about the South, if your heart and soul is not in Dixie, get out. Your heart and soul got to be in there. Because Mardi Gras Day, this suit is heavy. This bad boy, when you put it together, it is heavy. And then at night, you sitting up there, that Tuesday night, you sitting there drinking vinegar. Cramps, you know. You're hurting, your soul, your host, you know, and you're saying. Then 2 or 3 weeks later, you got to put the suit on again for the parade. Then you got the Super Sunday. You got St. Joseph night. Then you have the Creole Yasiola parade. Then you have the Jazz Fest, if you're invited to the Jazz Fest, you know what I'm saying?
Doris Chase Concepts is concerned with adding a new visual dimension to words, emotion, and dramatic theater. Mask is the journey of a black woman looking inside herself. It is a woman's attempt to unravel her history and discover her true source of strength.
My face. It glides like an ice skater with a sure knowledge of the ice. My hand is moving in a slow procession. It is creating a landscape on this surface. A surface that I do not recognize. My new look. I'll wear my gray flannel man-tailored suit, first seen in Vogue, sensible low-heeled shoes, my hair styled, and the Wall Street Journal tucked under my arm like a battle lance. I'll charge into that concrete canyon. I'll walk down Wall Street in my mufti, my face veiled by their illusion. Was I born a twin? Did my sister die at birth? Was she buried in a secret grave beside the Nile? In her voyage through the birth canal, did she take the umbilical cord in her baby fist and strangle herself? Rather than live in this exile. Mama, dressed in a mink chubby with a big corsage, smiling in a nightclub on VJ Day.
Mama called last night. Good luck tomorrow, honey. You'll be the first color director they have there. Mama, under siege from the day she was born. Just keep working hard. Dad on the basement extension next to his pool table. Work hard and be on time. No CP time. CP time. It's Billie Holiday singing behind the beat. Well, she's dead, you know, Dad would sing. If I take this off, my skin may come off too, like the flesh of the Hiroshima victims when they were touched. In my office, I can maneuver through the minefields of committee meetings, acres of computer readouts, like the lace on the wedding dress of some monster bride, the dead brown eyes in key punch. They say the working world will soon be silent. The robots are coming, and I am ready. I've been preparing all my life. Today, I will be promoted to director. The first, like Mama said, there'll be a big parade down the street back home. They'll tear to shreds their first-class tickets to Jamaica. All the women will don their best wigs. Wigs named Lisa and Nancy and Debbie. I will be acclaimed an authentic credit to the race. The race against myself. The race they all lost. Posing in the bathroom mirror, holding my official fan club portrait of Sandra D. Sandra is in half profile, her face turned saucily to whatever man owned a surfboard and a Mustang convertible. Her eyes flash scenes from the beach at Malibu. It never rains in California, the Mouseketeers sing. I sit in the mirror and practice Sandra's smile. Sandra's tilt of the head. Dad buys me a book about Harriet Tubman. But Sandra D is the heroine of my secret self. If I take this off, my skin may come off too, like the flesh of the Hiroshima victims when they were touched. church down south. It was like the blast. At Los Alamos, the blind could see the light. And I thought only old people died. Glad I left the south. Dad said while building a cabinet for his bowling trophy. Daddy, why do you work so much? Why aren't you ever here when I need you? Oh, 'cause I want you to go to good school and have nice clothes and lunch money. No dried up bologna sandwiches and greasy bags for you. Then, Daddy, are overcooked hamburgers made by somebody else's mother the reason you left Mississippi on the midnight train and joined Patton's army? You were a hard-eyed old man at 6 years old. One cold night during the McCarthy era, you stood up to a mob of men with Slavic names. Did you stand up to their northern industrial threats for a home in the suburbs, for children who took pride in not knowing the words to gospel songs? Mama, my skirt is bloody. Don't sneak me in the bathroom, Mama. Mama, you're talking too fast. Your words are too casual. No, Mama, I won't tell Daddy. Yes, Mama. I understand. I can't play with boys anymore. And I'll remember to keep my skirt down. Yes, Sister Calexta. I won't give occasion for sin. No, sister, I don't want a black soul. A black soul will send you to hell. Black is bad. Sister's pale blue eyes are like the oceans on the moon. Her hair, golden brown, inching from her wimple. I drew a self-portrait on white paper, and I did not color it in. Knowing that she'll understand. Before he went off to school, his name was David. Before he went off to school, he wore more brook brothers' shirts than anybody on the block. Pinks, blue, the whitest whites. He wore Jade East, and his pants were always creased. We used to sit on the front porch and talk about our fondest dreams to own LTDs. But when he came back, his name was Hassan. And he wouldn't eat my dad's special barbecue anymore. And he wore dashikis. And he spoke either very softly and slowly or very loudly with his arms waving in the air like the conductor of some ghost chorus. Now David Hassan had no dreams to share with me. Not until I let my hair grow into its natural state and walk two steps behind him. Our street, once so stately and serene, with the quiet of those afraid to be thought low-life, our street was quickly being filled with poets who lectured at the drop of a hat. One rainy night, while my parents were at a dinner party, Sandra D was torn into shreds. One rainy night, while my parents were at a dinner party, my hymen was torn into shreds by David Hassan, who said he was a warrior. Now, I was very correct in front of white people. I lived in a house where the women were four to a man, where I learned to prepare millet traditionally and run a mimeograph machine. I shared David Hassan in tribal compliance until the hot afternoon he took me to a surgeon under the L tracks, a friend of the family. He had skin the color of cold coffee, and he touched me far too long. A man who traveled to the land of his ancestors on safari, who drank schnapps at treetops with the Prince of Wales. A man who brought back dead animals and displayed their heads at cocktail parties. He told me not to tell David Hassan that it was a boy. He slipped me his telephone number for a drink sometime. If I take this off, my skin may come off too, like the flesh of the Hiroshima victims when they were touched.
Abroad, I stopped pretending to be the long-lost princess of some long-lost tribe from some long-lost Africa. In a bedroom in Paris, with a man whose hair was the color of the noonday sun, I tore off all his stolen jewelry from Botswana land. And I forgot my French. I forgot everything. Of various ages, and I will dazzle those pale white patriarchs with a Cecil B. DeMille spectacular brought to you by 400 years on the job training, survival of the middle passage. And how dare they say that we are only 30,000.
Among themselves, they see. And if women are slaves, and I the descendant of slaves, am a special slave, who will be my deliverer? My deliverer? Whenever I prayed as a child, I could not imagine the creator of all life to be a man. Men were once little boys, and little boys used their fists and got their faces dirty, and pushed and shoved each other, and shot birds out of trees with their zip guns, and drowned cats, and made fun of you if you couldn't run fast. And I couldn't pray to a creator who did all of that when he was a little boy. I couldn't pray to a creator who did all of that when he was a little boy. Women were once little girls who pushed their dollies and buggies and who had time to hug a kitten and who helped you find a Band-Aid if you'd cut yourself. Women had babies and fed them from their own bodies and kept them warm with their own bodies. Yes, I knew all of this when I was a child. And so I could not imagine the creator of all life to be a man. I tried, but I just couldn't imagine it. No one would talk to me about it. No one at all. Not even my own mother. And so I learned to speak with those for whom the act of speaking is not their sole means of communication. Those whose communication is real and direct and true. And I found a mother God, the goddess within me. Within all women. Babies speak to me. And animals too, as do flowers. I look inside the clear eyes of a baby. And we have conversations. We say, if you can understand the beginning, then you can understand the end. The beginning was this. A small black woman, newly freed, no living husband, 5 babies, set out for the north. With nothing but the clothes on her back and an address. She was a farmer, and she knew the land. She paid homage to her work. She cooked, she washed, she sewed, and she sent her children to school. But they did not have her analysis. They moved into fine homes, and along the way, they lost her. They bought, they sold, they did dirt, and they believed in profit first. And now my hand is moving with a life of its own. My hand talking to me like my great-great-grandmother talking to me. A tiny old lady, her face full of wrinkles the color of ebony. Smoking a pipe in bed. Once I said to her, Mama, I don't want to go to that old birthday party. And she said to me, her eyes shining like beacons, Child, it's your life. Ain't nobody else's but your own. Now they can catch you up in this mess. But you've got to change things. It ain't too hard to figure out. Life ain't nothing but change. It's your life. Nobody else's but your own.
Thank you for joining us. With me, I have 4 members of the Roy family. I have Marinao Roy.
That's it.
Okay. Ratna Roy, Prodipto, and Shamali. Right? Okay. You're all members of the Urvashi group, dance group.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Why don't we talk just a tiny bit of Urvashi? What is Urvashi?
Well, Urvashi Audrey is a mythical character. She was the most prized dancer in the court of heavens. She's beauty personified, without beginning, without end. So we thought that with this dance group and the art that we are doing, Urvashi would be kind of appropriate name.
How long have you been in the Northwest?
Oh, quite a while. Since 1974 we are in Seattle area. Prior to that we were in Pullman, and then before that in Oregon.
How responsive have you found, let's say, Indian dance to the people in the Northwest area? Do they come and see you dance?
Quite a few, yes. It's been growing. More and more people are enjoying the dances.
How many dances do you usually have in a set, in a repertoire?
About 50 or 60 dances.
Between you and Shemily, you learn all of the dances?
Yes, we know more, but we keep about 60 for the year that we perform.
You do more than just do dances. You also teach, right?
That's right.
How has that been going?
Well, we've enjoyed teaching. Both of us teach. And we teach at the colleges and also teach dancing.
So you teach throughout the Northwest mm-hmm. also?
Yes, the number of students has increased through times, and some of our students are making public appearances now, Americans. So we are very happy to share what we have with the people of the Northwest.
Let's talk about some of the differences between Western dances and Indian dances.
Wow.
Is there are similarities and there are differences. So let's deal first of all with the things that are different.
Okay. Indian classical dance is more rooted to the ground and more individual rather than group. For instance, in ballet, you will find the dancers would stretch out or leap up and come down as if they are not down yet. The movements are soft, as if the dream is out there. Mm. And when you see in ballet, you are transported to a dream, and then suddenly at the end you come back to reality. Indian dance, classical dance, is just the opposite. It starts with a very mundane note. Here I am, the dancer. I'm dancing, this dance is for you in this particular place. This is how I have decked myself, and I'm dancing. So it starts there with very grim reality. And then slowly the audience is transported to the dream. And when it ends, they do not realize which one is real.
What about the similarities?
Similarities you will find in the classical dance, Indian dance, and ballet, some similar foot positions, for instance, are there, like demi-plié. It's also there in the dances that we have. But Indian dance also incorporated the hand gestures, facial expressions, and the entire body must coordinate properly to express what is being said. It's considered as an art form, like a play, where every little bit works together to bring out the message.
Okay, why don't we look at the dances and
sure.
see what we see.
Bhavakhandana muni jana mana Sanjana, Janaranjana, he, Janaranjana, Jadu Kula, Nalina, Dinesha, Jaya, Jaya, Deva, Hare, 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 Jaya, Jaya, Deva, Hare.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Bumper Shoot and Le Petit Cirque. Before this afternoon's performance, I have a couple quick reminders. Your ticket into Bumper Shoot today will also get you into the Space Needle and the EMP for half price. In addition, you can get into the Seattle Children's Museum completely free. We would like to thank Seattle's Child for sponsoring this stage today. And with that, I give you Les Oiseaux du Paradis.
Thank you. background. I was the drum major in my high school marching band. I listened to The Doors. I listened to Jimi Hendrix. I listened to jazz music. What else? Oh, I played classical music. You know, obviously I'm black and I grew, but I went to like Northeastern. It was at Yale and at Tufts and sort of like kind of like all over the place. And that's my experience. So, and like when I started dancing, I studied, I loved movie musicals and stuff like that, all different kinds of sort of dancing. So I didn't differentiate between the part that was entertainment and the part that was like high art part. Even after when I started to study, it was all dancing to me. There was never like some major distinction between them or that one was better than the other, or, you know, it was just dancing. It was different styles of dancing, but it was all dancing, and I loved it. And I loved good dancing. I loved great dancing. I loved wonderful, exciting dancing, and I loved good choreography. I mean, I loved some of those things that Hermes Pan did in those movies and the Fred Astaire things, and I loved, you know, early Twyla, and I loved Balanchine, and I just loved everybody. So what, anybody that was good or exciting, you know, I didn't care where it was coming from. You know, I loved, when I saw, what's her name, Keita Kay, you know, I just liked a lot of different kinds of things. So for me, like, describe my movement is that my movement and the work that I do is an expression of my experiences in many ways. It's a kind of synthesis or a distillation of my experiences as how it, you know, how it manifests and expresses itself through movement. And so my movement is all of those things. And in some cases it may, you know, like, I don't think it looks incongruous together, that it doesn't look disturbing to people, that it's like it's really been, I think for the most part it makes sense to people. I mean, some people don't like it, some people really like it, some people don't get it, you know, whatever, but it looks the way it looks because that's because of the experiences that I've had, and it looks, and I think it looks very kind of American, and, you know, it's just, it's hard to describe what it is. Some of it looks like something anybody could do. I mean, one of the things I used to say is that I wanted people to look at it and say, oh, I could do that, you know, I could do that. And then to have people that are trained to go, oh, I'd like to do that, or that looks hard. I mean, depending on how trained the eye is, they'll see the things that they can do or the things that looks different. I mean, they can appreciate it on a lot of different levels, but what would I say it looks like?
Janice, guess what? The slides from Trinidad and Tobago are here. Yeah, they're ready. Okay. All right, listen, I'll meet you in 15 minutes in the park. Okay? All right, bye.
Ha 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 ha!